So I titled tonight's message, I mean, I try to give most of the messages a title of some sort, and I just basically took the scripture, and it comes from Revelation 11, verse 15, where it says, and the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And so what I titled tonight's message is that when the kingdoms of the world become the kingdoms of our Lord, or the kingdoms of the Christ. And, you know, to some people, especially like even in much of the preaching that we see nowadays, you know, a hyper-prosperity type message that focuses on a positive confession. I don't know if any of y'all know what I'm talking about or not, but it comes from the faith doctrine, you know, the word of faith doctrine, where you have to say the right thing and you confess the right thing, and the next thing you know, you're going to be driving a better car and wearing better clothes and various things of that nature, and everything's focused on your blessing on this earth, and that if you don't have better clothes and you don't have a better car, then you're really not blessed, or you don't have enough faith. And I have to tell you that for somebody like that, it's going to be a little bit difficult for them to come to the right realization of what this scripture is saying. When the seventh trumpet is blown, and then this, what happens is that the voices in heaven say the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord. And so the question, if you're really going to study the scriptures and you're really going to look closely at the words, because we do believe in the inspiration of scripture, amen? Yeah. That the Holy Spirit spoke in man and through man and used man to pen his word. And so we're supposed to pay close attention. But if you see that passage of scripture, you cannot come to any other conclusion than to realize that right now the kingdoms of this earth are not completely belonging to God. Now, we always clarify that in the sense that God is ultimately sovereign in control, amen? But that he allows things to continue on in a certain way. He allows the enemy of him and the enemy of mankind to have power and to exert power in a certain direction for a certain period of time. But there's coming a day, and when this seventh trumpet sounds, the proclamation is coming forth that the kingdoms that have been upon this earth now are being given back over to God, amen, and that he, the Christ, will reign forever and ever. Now, what I did was I just put a couple of scriptures side by side, and I just wanted to make a point. So, in Revelation 11:15, what we just read, what we see is that the kingdoms of the world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. It's a proclamation that's going forth. A word is being spoken by these voices in heaven. But this, whenever these voices are speaking, this truth has not yet come to pass. I mean, it's already come to pass in a spiritual sense. The word of God says it. It's done. Amen. But the fact of the matter is that even whenever these voices say it, this has not come to pass yet in the book of Revelation. But it's a proclamation that's telling us it's coming. It's about to happen. And then in chapter 14, verse 15, which we'll look at a little bit closer when we get there, it says, another angel came out of the temple crying with a loud voice to him that sat on the cloud, thrust in your sickle and reap, for the time is come for thee to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. And one of the main things that I would like to get across to you, and I've kind of mentioned this type of concept before, but let me just say it again. That for all of these years, this is supposed to be the Tower of Babel, all of these years, mankind has been finding himself swayed to the lies of the enemy. The enemy has offered to man power, riches, fortune, and fame in exchange. I mean, this is just reality. I'm not just telling you something that I Googled. I'm telling you something you can find in the Bible. Amen? That he's offered them power, fortune, fame, prestige, in order for them to throw their alignment in with him. Now, most of the people that we know that have money or have material possessions have not necessarily gone that route. But nevertheless, there's people at high levels that have, and there's been a, if you will, a trickle-down effect in the sense that the forces of evil have pushed humanity in a certain direction. And this has been going on since the ancient days. Mm-hmm. And so with the Tower of Babel, what we see is an attempt at a one world order. I mean, am I telling you the truth? What did they say? I mean, I really didn't want to get into it too deep, but what did they say? Come, let us make bricks. Let us make a name for ourselves. Let us build ourselves a city. Let us build ourselves a tower that reaches into the heavens. Now, anybody that's been coming to the church for a while, we know that at least I believe with all my heart, that because it used to stump me, that we're not talking about linear height. We're not talking about a tower that's going to reach into heaven. And so God got concerned because they were going to be knocking on his door. So he went down there and confused their languages. No, he doesn't do that to people that build skyscrapers. But that instead they were engaging the second heavens. In other words, they were engaging in occult worship. And they were hearing from other entities, demonic spirits. And listen, this stuff still goes on today. Hearing from demonic spirits that were leading them and guiding them to move forward in a certain direction to rebel against God and to rebel against God's plan. And I've shared some of this with you before. Some of you that have been around a while, I've read things from more modern day people that were occultists that literally would pray these things out and recite these prayers. And one of them was Alice Bailey. And the reason that I say her a lot is because it just sends chills up my spine whenever I just quote a little portion of what she said. She said, to those of us who know the plan. So there's a plan going on. Now we know the plan. Amen? Amen. We know the plan. We know the plan is going to work. But she said, to the millions of us that know the plan, there's another plan that's been going on, and there's millions of them that know about it. She said, this is a prayer, she called it, or an invocation that we can incite. And what they were doing together was they were inviting Lucifer, the fallen angel, to come back upon this earth and to rule and reign and to have dominion. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that way back here at Babel, there was the attempt to come together, one voice, one plan, and to produce a new world order. Well, whenever God, you know, let me just say this, the word Babel literally means gate of God. Or it could be interpreted gate of the gods. And so this just gives further proof to the fact that they weren't just building some tower to try to reach into a physical heaven, but instead they were trying to open up doorways to reach gods, not the God, but gods, fallen angels, demonic spirits. But what happened was is that whenever God confused the languages, that the word became synonymous with confusion and confusion of language. So the word actually changed in its meaning because of what God did when he confused the languages at Babel. But so for all of these thousands of years until we come to the end, and this is what we're talking about in these passages of Scripture, there's been a parallel course, and I made a slide to try to explain what I'm trying to talk about. And I wouldn't have written it like this on purpose, but I got the bad people on top, and to put God's plan down here, salvation history. I don't have much chalk left. But salvation history, and so God's got a plan that he's moving forward with, but at the same time, there's a work of the enemy that's been going on, and God's been allowing this work to take place. Now, what I'm trying to tell you is that, once again, the modern hyper-prosperity preacher and the modern hyper, they don't even have a clue, dude. I'm telling you, you go listen to the majority of the garbage that's being preached on TBN, and the majority of the garbage that's being preached in the modern church, and they don't even realize that you're in the midst of a war. They're over there worried about how they're going to get some shine put on their shoe. And God's over here saying, hey, I want you to wake up. I need vessels that'll let me fill myself up with them to be used by me to explain to a lost and a dying world that we're in a real war. There's a spiritual Amen. War that's taking place. Amen. Not just for your individual soul. That's bad enough. Amen? But in reality, For the masses. And God has chosen to use people like you and people like me as vessels to get engaged in other people's lives. Now, everybody won't necessarily stand behind a pulpit, but the reality of it is that he's called each and every one of us to let our light shine in the midst of darkness. He wants the gospel of Jesus Christ to be planted on the inside of you in such a way, amen, that you will allow the light of Jesus to come out of you. That's another thing you won't hear people talking about in churches because it makes people uncomfortable. You're supposed to be a personal witness for Jesus. I'm not shrinking back from that. Even if I didn't witness to somebody today like I should have, by the grace of God, He opened up a door and I was able to. But even if I wouldn't have done that, that does not take away from the fact that that's what the Word of God says. We're supposed to be light in the midst of darkness. Hallelujah. How can we shrink back from that truth? We can't, and still preach the gospel. But so here it is right here. Let's just go ahead and read. It says in verse 16, "And the 24 elders which sat before God on their seats fell upon their faces and worshiped God, saying, We give thee thanks, O Lord, God Almighty, which art and was and art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy great power and has reigned." Now I want you to think about that for a second, because as I was reading it, I was realizing all of this is taking place in heaven. The seventh trumpet is blown. Voices begin to cry out that the kingdoms of the earth have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of His Christ. And now the 24 elders, they begin to worship the Lord. And then they begin to say, this is what they say, "You have taken unto yourself your great power." I mean, you and I understand the power of God. At least we believe what the Word of God says. We understand the power that God has. I mean, we just get a glimpse of it. You know, this is just coming to me as I'm sitting here talking. We just get a glimpse of it by seeing the person of Jesus in the garden. When they came to get Him. Yeah. Remember that? Yeah. In the Gospel of John. They came to get Him. And He says, "Whom do you seek?" They say, "Jesus of Nazareth." And in the Greek, it doesn't say, "I am He." In the King James translators, if you look at it, they put the pronoun "He" in there. It's not in the Greek. Mm-hmm. He said, "I am." The same thing that happened whenever the burning bush spoke to Moses. Mm-hmm. You tell Pharaoh, "I am sent you." And when He said, "I am," the next thing you know, all of them fell down under the power of God. We see just a glimpse of that. He told them, "If you think that I could not call upon a legion of angels and destroy the whole lot of you," but what these elders are saying, you got to get a revelation of this. They're in heaven. They see real clearly now. You and I are seeing through a glass, the Apostle Paul said. It's a glass that's dim and we can't see through it. But there's coming a day when we're going to have clarity and we're going to be able to see real clearly. That day hadn't come for us yet, but for these elders, they see it all. They see the magnitude. They see the splendor. They see the glory. They see the power of God. And what they say is, "You have taken unto you your great power." All this time, God's been restraining Himself. For all of these thousands of years of human history, God's been restraining Himself, holding back, if you will, allowing this thing to move forward for a purpose. Amen. Whenever we preach the book of Ephesians, one of the main things that the Lord gave me, a new revelation that I'd never seen before. God is creating an eternal family. Amen. You need to know that tonight. God is creating an eternal family, and your temporary circumstances on this earth are not supposed to control you and move you in the direction that you feel as though you want to go. You're supposed to think of something big. You're supposed to have your eyes on something bigger. Amen? I'm supposed to have my eyes on something bigger. We need the Lord to help us to stay focused. Amen? And I was telling somebody that today, a nursing student. And anyway, that's another story. But so He took unto Him His great power. And look at what it says in verse 18. "And the nations were angry." I don't think that I have to overly try to convince people that have been coming to the church for a while. But when I tell you that there is an organized rebellion by the enemy that is so much more organized than what you and I give him credit for, that it's unbelievable.
That's right.
And it says, "The nations were angry, and your wrath is come, and the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that thou shouldest give reward unto your servants, the prophets, and to the saints, and them that fear your name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth." And so what I really want you to see is that as this seventh trumpet is blown, and these voices say that the kingdoms of the earth have become the kingdoms of the Lord and of His Christ, that now we're being moved in a certain direction. From this point forward, what's going to happen is that we're going to see a movement towards the Battle of Armageddon. God is about to exact judgment on the earth. The way that He chooses to take this earth back, and I said it a while back, and I don't know if it was a good analogy or not, But I was trying to make the point, I guess I'm going to have technical difficulties. I was trying to make the point that whenever we invaded Iraq the last time, and I can remember I was watching the news back then, and they talked about shock and awe. Remember that? And they had those, I think there were battleships that were maybe in the Persian Gulf. And I mean, they just sent those missiles. It was just unbelievable the amount of missiles that we rained on them. And I was thinking about that whenever we were talking about the trumpets. And you remember how they had hail and fire that was mingled with blood, and you see, and the rivers are turning to blood, and the ocean is turning to blood, and men are dying, and it's like this mercy ran out that day. Mercy and grace ran out.
Yeah.
And God is, now we're hearing in the seventh trumpet that God is about to harvest or take back the earth for himself. But in the process, he's going to judge unrepentant man. Judgment is coming upon those that have refused to serve God and have refused to go his way.
Yeah.
And so then we transition into to chapter 12. And I don't really even know. I'm glad I kind of went forward with this. But I wanted to just show you the similarities to reap the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord, and to reap, and that one is a proclamation, and that the second one is speaking of literally thrusting in your sickle and taking the harvest. Okay, and so we're not there yet. This is actually regarding chapter 13, but let's go ahead and go to chapter 12 as far as this slide. And so let's go ahead and look at chapter 12 a little bit. And what I want you to know, I'm just going to give you an overall concept of chapter 12. There's a wonder that takes place in the sky, or a sign that happens in the sky. And it says, it speaks of this woman, and it says that she's clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. I know we've talked about most of these chapters more than once since we started the book of Revelation, or since we started this end time study. But I have to be honest with you, if you haven't studied it a lot, then you're probably okay with us going over it more than once. If you studied it in great detail, you might be getting tired after a little while. But, you know, it's going to be okay, because, you know what, we only got about three more installments of the book of Revelation, and then we're going to move on. But what I want you to see is that there's a wonder that's taking place in the heavens. And it's almost like, at least the way that I see it. Now, there's a lot of people that will tell you, and it's just really above my intellect on this, because I just don't understand it. But there's people that will tell you that there are certain constellations that will align themselves and have aligned themselves in the past and will do it again, of, say, Virgo. Some people will tell you that God actually preached the gospel when he slung the stars in the sky and the constellations that are there, that they actually tell the story of a virgin birth and all of these other things. And I have to tell you that it very well may be true. At the same time, Nimrod, over there at the Tower of Babel, he began to pervert things. And with his science of astrology, he began to take all of these constellations and turned it into occult magic. So we just have to be careful. I don't know it well enough to sit here and teach it to you, but I find it interesting that they say that literally at some point in time, I don't remember when it is, it might be in 2017 or something like that, there's going to be an alignment of certain constellations where Virgo, which is supposed to represent the virgin, is going to be pregnant with the planet Jupiter, which is the king planet. And all of these things like line up to where it theoretically could actually be a manifestation in the sky of what this passage of scripture is saying. It could very well be true for us. I mean, do you doubt that God could do such a thing if he wanted to, is my point. But what I want to focus on is this. What I see happening, and it very well may be that it happens physically in the sky, but what I see almost happening is a picture of a movie being displayed in the sky. And what I mean by a movie is that what's being displayed is salvation history. The story of God is being displayed in the heavens. It's a wonder that's taking place, and there's a woman. And this woman is clothed with the sun, and she's got the moon beneath her feet, and she has 12 stars. If you go back to the prophecy in the book of Genesis of Joseph, whenever he had his dream, this undoubtedly is speaking of Israel. This is speaking of Israel and the birth of Israel before there ever was a nation called Israel. And the 12 tribes represent the 12 tribes of Israel. And so what is being depicted here is not Mary. The Catholic Church would put Mary on a pedestal and put some stars on her head and say that this is a revelation of Mary. No, this is talking about Israel. Israel as a woman was the womb that gave birth to Messiah. Now, the question that we've talked about this before is this, and I'm going to leave it to you Bible students to come to your own conclusion. But what it says is that she's pregnant with a male child, and she's ready to give birth. And there's differing interpretations of that passage. Some people, and it's people that I respect, would tell you that this represents the 144,000 that are sealed with the seal of God that will preach during the Great Tribulation. Some people say, no, this is talking about the man-child, Jesus. And that this is an overall story of salvation history. She's pregnant with the man-child, Jesus, and the dragon. I didn't want to read the whole chapter to you, but you can kind of look at it as I'm talking. There's another wonder in heaven of a great red dragon. And the dragon is ready to devour the male child when she's going to give birth. But that the male child is brought up to heaven. And so some people would tell you that that's the rapture of the 144,000. Whereas other people who think it's Jesus would say, no, that's Jesus when he died on the cross, was resurrected and ascended unto the Father. So what I just want to tell you is this, is that there's a couple of other scriptures that talk about one of the things, like in verse 5, it says, in verse chapter 12, verse 5, let me just read it, some of this passage to you so that we can all be on the same page. Chapter 12, verse 1. There appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth, and pain to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. Now I am glad that I slowed down, and I went back and read, because I wanted to make a point. Because what we're talking about here, I preached a message one time in Galliano at that little camp meeting called the Epic of God. And I remember I preached this passage of scripture, and how I saw this passage of scripture was once again as though it's a movie being displayed in the heavens that's telling us the whole story of salvation history. How God had a plan of a virgin that would give birth to a child, and that there was a great red dragon that desired to devour it. And then as we move on in the chapter, we're going to see that there's a spiritual war that takes place, and God is the overcomer, amen, and he's the conqueror. But what I did want to point out to you was two things. Number one, look at verse 3. And it talks about the fact that this dragon had 7 heads with 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. So 7 heads and 10 horns. And, you know, whenever we get in, we're going to read a little bit also in chapters 17 and 18 if we get there tonight. And what we're going to see is that there's a beast, and the beast has 7 heads and 10 crowns. And what I want you to know, though, is this, is that this represents, at least definitely in chapter 17, this beast system represents the nations that have come against God. And we'll explain it a little bit more when we get there, through the ages. And so what you're seeing in this first part in verse 3 is how physical humanity, how mankind, and I've already said this before, has thrown their lot in with the evil one. In other words, if the 7 heads definitely in chapter 17 represent the forces of the nations that have rebelled against God, then I'm just trying to show you that humanity has rebelled against God and thrown their lot in with Satan. But then in the first part of verse 4, it says, and his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven. Does anybody know what that's talking about? His tail, huh?
Fallen angels.
Fallen angels. And that's where we get the passage that a third of the angels fell with Satan. And so what we see here is a combination between the spiritual and the physical. that there's fallen angels, a third of them that have thrown their lot in with Satan, and at the same time, they're moving and operating through humanity in this physical realm, and I just wanted to kind of point that out to you. And so as it goes on to say in verse 4, and the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And she brought forth the man-child, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. So, you know, right there, I'm just trying to make a point. I probably shouldn't belabor this point, but I'm not trying to convince you of something. You study and come to your own conclusions. But the choices, once again, are, is this male child the 144,000, or is this the man child Christ? Well, first of all, it talks about the fact that he was caught up to God and to his throne. All right? And so that's one thing. But then I want you to also notice in verse 5, she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. So I did a search on that because I knew that there were several, at least a few scriptures in the Bible that talked about ruling with a rod of iron. One of them is in this verse, obviously. And then in another one, it's in chapter 19, verse 5. I mean, if you want to turn there, you can. I don't want to spend too much time on this, but I did want to make a point because whenever I come to a place where there can be more than one interpretation, I just want to try to dig a little bit deeper so that we can try to come to the right understanding. It says in Revelation, 19:5? Yeah. I think it's supposed to be 1950. It says in Revelation 19:15, well, if we go up to verse 12, we'll get a little bit of a better, let's go up to verse 11. Sorry about that. Chapter 19, verse 11. I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. Now, you remember when we talked about the seven seals, that when the first seal opened up, that there was a rider on a white horse that had a bow without arrows, and that he was coming speaking peace. He was the counterfeit Christ. He was the Antichrist. This is the real Christ. He's also on a white horse, but this is the real Jesus right here. Amen. It says, I saw heaven open, behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called faithful and true, and in righteousness he does judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. Now, I will tell you this. This is interesting. That there are multiple scriptures that we could do a study on that would show that in this army are contained both saints, those that were purchased with the blood of Jesus, and also angels. So just as the enemy, in the verses we were just reading, had human leaders, which we'll see in a minute, that have thrown their lot in with him, and at the same time, a third of the angels have thrown their lot in with him. God, amen, has. So he's trying to, the enemy's always trying to counterfeit everything that God desires to do. But it says right here in verse 15, and out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. So there's another passage of scripture that's undoubtedly talking about Jesus and talking about a rod of iron and ruling nations, specifically is what it says. And in the passage that we just read, it's talking about that. To rule all nations with a rod of iron. Now, to be fair, what I will say is that in Revelation chapter 2, if you want to turn there, in Revelation chapter 2, verse 27, we really need to kind of go up a little bit, at least go to verse 25. It says, but that which you have already, hold fast. He's speaking to the church of Thyatira right here, if I'm not mistaken, starting in verse 18, okay? Yeah, and because it says it again in verse 24. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, this is verse 24, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan, as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden, but that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. And he that overcomes and keeps my works until the end, to him will I give power over the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. So here's a passage of scripture that says, that talks about people that are in the church, specifically the church of Thyatira, and that they also will rule with a rod of iron. But it's talking about overcomers. Amen. And it's talking about overcomers during the church age. It's talking about believers in Christ. That because the truth is that during the millennial reign of Christ, we're going to rule and reign with him. The reality of it is that it's not really our rod of iron. Amen. It's just like it is in our cross. Even whenever the preacher tells you, oh, Jesus bore his cross, but you got your own cross you got to bear. No, I know what it says. Luke 9:23. It talks about that if any man wants to follow after me, let him deny himself and pick up his own cross and follow after me. His cross is your cross. And don't get me wrong, you're going to go through trial and tribulation upon this earth, but you better learn how to associate and identify yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ and his cross so that you can receive the grace that you need in order to walk this journey of self-abnegation, as the scholar would call it, meaning self-denial, self-sacrifice, self-dying. Because if you don't get a hold of the real Jesus and learn how to get a hold of some real grace, you ain't going to let yourself die. Amen? And so I just want you to know you're not going to carry a cross and carry a burden and add to anything that Jesus has already done. He's accomplished what needs to be done, and there's grace waiting and power waiting for the child of God. Amen? Yes. And so it says here, right, but what I wanted to point out to you was is that those are believers, but I want to make a point. The 144,000 aren't the church.
No.
The 144,000 are 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes. So that means they're Jews. And they're not during the church age. They're after in the midst of the Great Tribulation. And then there's one more passage of scripture I wanted to show you. And it's in Psalm chapter 2. And we probably would have looked at Psalm chapter 2 at some point anyway. But because it's talking about this very thing, this whole concept that we're talking about tonight, which is this battle that's going on. It says in verse 9. Well, let's go up to verse 7. It says, I will declare the decree the Lord has said unto me. Thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee. And so what he's talking about there is that, you know, Jesus was never created. You got to know that. He's the eternal word that spoke the world into existence. Yeah. God used him to create. God the Father used the eternal Son, who was the eternal word, to speak the worlds into existence. When it says, this day have I begotten thee, he's talking about the incarnation. He's talking about the fact that the Christ, the eternal word, became flesh. Amen? And for the purpose that he always had for him, which was that he would be the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Yeah. So it says, I will declare the decree, says the Lord, you are my son, this day have I begotten thee. Ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession. Thou shalt break them with a rod of iron, thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. So I just wanted to point out those, you know, there's two different interpretations of this Revelation 12 passage, but I am of the opinion that what we're talking about here is the nation of Israel giving birth to the male child, which is the Christ, and that what we're really seeing displayed in the heavens is the eternal message of salvation history, that we have a child being born who's going to rule the nations with a rod of iron, and that there's a great red dragon that's ready to try to devour the plan. But I got good news for you. He can't destroy the plan. Yeah. The Christ became flesh, walked this earth, lived a sinless life, and offered it on the cross. Hallelujah. Death had no right to hold him down. He resurrected and busted out of the grave. He's ascended to the Father, and he's seated at the right hand. Amen. It's too late to try to destroy it. But hallelujah, but I will tell you one thing, he will try to pervert it.
That's
right. Well, I was talking to somebody before church, and I'm telling you right now, one of the first things this person ever told me, I was carrying the cross, and the first thing this person told me when he got out to come talk to me, he said, the church is in a mess. I'm like, yeah, you got that right, bro. The church is in a mess. You hear what I'm trying to tell you? You got false doctrine that abounds. Nobody's focused on the Lord. Nobody's focused on his work at Calvary that gives grace. And everybody's got a different answer on how you're going to have victory. No, you got to hold on to the truth of the gospel. This is the plan. And the enemy wants to try to pervert the plan. But look, there's coming a day when he's going to try to attempt to do it again, to try to exalt himself above the throne of God. He promised it in Isaiah. He's already been cast out once. Jesus said, I saw Satan fall like lightning to the earth. Now, how would Jesus have seen that? I mean, in other words, there's no way that he could have seen that in his flesh, in his physical body, right?
Yeah.
Satan fell in ages past. He saw that as the eternal word before the incarnation. He viewed it and he said, I saw Satan fall like lightning to the earth. But he's going to attempt it again. The enemy's going to try to exalt himself again. And what I want you to really, I'm wanting to paint this picture for you, is that when that trumpet was sounded and it said the kingdoms of the earth had become the kingdoms of our Lord and his Christ, it's setting into motion all of these things, and now we're seeing it being built upon it. And so here's something that's getting ready to take place in the spiritual realm, starting in verse 7. It says, bless you. It says, and there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil, and Satan, which deceives the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Bless you. So is there a contradiction in the scripture? Like, in other words, Jesus said, I saw Satan fall from heaven to the earth. So if Jesus said, I saw Satan fall from the heavens to the earth, and now in this scripture it's saying that he was cast out, is there a discrepancy? No, there's not. And let me tell you why. Because what's going on here is this. Is that in this passage of scripture, if we go back in time to the book of Job, what does it say in the book of Job? It says that Satan presented himself to God, and that the sons of God came along with him. Now, if you've never studied this, that wording sons of God is talking about fallen angels. There's no doubt about it. I mean, I've studied this in detail. I mean, you got to do the research. It talks about it in the book of Genesis, chapter 6. I mean, we got maybe a couple of visitors here tonight. We just need to go ahead and introduce you to the way we preach the gospel. Because maybe your preacher never told you. But the Word of God says in Genesis chapter 6 that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they came in unto them. And that there were giants in those days. And the sons of God is talking about fallen angels. And that a hybrid race of something that wasn't human and wasn't angel was walking on the face of the earth before the flood. Now there's other documents that allude to this and go into greater detail. Things like the book of Enoch. We're not going to get into all that. Although the Bible does quote the book of Enoch. And in the book of Enoch it says there were specifically 200 of these angels that descended. And not only that, they were tatted up with sorceries and witchcrafts. And then they were teaching people spells. And I mean, look, it was bad. You hear me? And that's why God destroyed that earth. Because it was, and all man could think about all day long was wickedness. And the word there, when it speaks of the sons of God, it's talking about fallen angels. And again, in the book of Job, it's talking about fallen angels. Satan presented himself into heaven, and the sons of God came along with him. Not because they're going to go try to take his throne, because they got to give an account to him. Where have you been, Satan? Up and down, to and fro. And then the Lord says, have you considered my servant Job? And what I need you to know is this, is that from the beginning until this day right here that we're reading about, the enemy of your soul has, when he goes up there to present himself, he's accusing you. He's accusing you, and he's accusing me. Because there's none of us in this room that have arrived. And all of us have failed the Lord. And the reality of it is that he's accusing us and accusing the brethren day and night before the Lord. But hallelujah, there's coming a day when he's going to try and he's going to attempt to gain a victory over God, and his angels are going to fight against the angels of God, but he's going to be cast out, and he's no longer going to even be coming up there to give an account of what he's doing. And then it says, but woe to the inhabitants of the earth, for he comes down with great fury because he knows that his time is short. He knows what the Word of God says.
Yes, right.
The Word of God says that whenever the end of the Battle of Armageddon is over, he's going to be chained up and he's going to be put into a pit for 1,000 years. And then after that, for another short period of time, then he's going to go into Gehenna, which is the lake of fire. And so I want you to just see how this situation's mounting. There's a trumpet that's blown, and it says the kingdoms of the earth have become the kingdoms of our God. Satan tries to gain a victory in the spiritual realm, but he's cast down to the earth. And then in the next chapter is where this picture comes from. Because it talks about in chapter 13, and I'm not going to really read it. I just want to kind of give you an idea. Two beasts. It mentions two beasts. And the first beast is that one that has those seven heads and ten horns. I do want to take some time and try to talk about that. Now, I know I've talked about it to most of you that have been here, but if the right interpretation is what I think it is, then these seven heads are representative of seven nations. All right. So these seven nations that are being represented here represent nations that have been in conflict with God and God's people from the beginning. The first one would be Egypt. Assyria took captive the northern kingdom. You remember we talked, does anybody remember how many tribes were in the northern kingdom? We just, somebody
ten.
Yelled.
Ten.
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 All right. You're not allowed to say that anymore, man. You got to let other people talk. I'm disgusted. Assyria took the northern kingdom, which was 10 tribes. Babylon took the southern kingdom, which was how many tribes?
Two.
Persia defeated Babylon. Then Greece, Alexander the Great, came in and destroyed them. And then his kingdom, when he died, was split into four. And one of those generals became the Roman Empire. And from there, the empire of the Antichrist is going to come from the ten kings that are connected to the seven-headed beast. And so what I want you to see is that, and I know I've explained this a lot, but I really feel like we need to get this in our an understanding. This beast and these seven heads represent these governments that have existed. This has been an ongoing thing. You see that? This has been an ongoing thing. We can map it out. Tower of Babel, the Exodus, Egypt, and then, you know, a few hundred years later, Assyria, and then a few hundred years later, Babylon, and a few hundred years later, you get the point. Through the ages. Chronologically, we can map it out. Yes, there's been somewhat of a space of in between before the kingdom of the Antichrist, but I wanted you to see that. So there's two beasts that are mentioned in this passage of Scripture, and one of the beasts is literally, he's going to be a leader that comes from this system, and he's the Antichrist, and he's a world leader. He's a government official, ultimately. So the beast is a system that contains all of these kingdoms and is being driven by the spirit of Antichrist. You understand there's a spirit connected behind the spirit of Antichrist. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 2 says it. I can't really quote it off the top of my head right this second, but I can read it to you real quick. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 2. Well, I'll read it in verse 1 and 2. And you has he quickened, that means he's given you life, who were dead in trespasses and sins, where in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. There's a spirit of the prince of the power of the air. It's the spirit of Antichrist. It's the opposition against God and his Holy Spirit, moving the children of disobedience in a certain direction. Now, we're just not just talking about like whenever Matt used to party and like would guzzle a beer and crush it on his head and like, hey, let's do this. No, that's low-level stuff. We're talking about a spirit of Antichrist that's moving nations and leaders and the whole world in a certain direction ultimately to come into rebellion against God. And that's what we're talking about in these chapters of Revelation. All this is starting to come to a head in these passages of Scripture. And so that's the first beast. And then the second one is actually the false prophet. And that's why I put these pictures up here. I just found it interesting whenever... Who said that? Chad. Whenever we were talking about what was going on in Syria. Because I didn't know that, because I told y'all I quit watching the news. But what y'all told me was some stuff's going on in Syria. And that all this mess is going on. And so the Pope is supposed to go over there and he's going to bring peace. And I don't know if he's going to sign a treaty or not or whatever, because I didn't hear it from myself. But I mean, he's going to speak some words of peace. It may not happen. But I'm telling you, I'm sitting on the edge of my seat waiting for something like that to happen. I'm telling you right now, my foot's just doing this number here. I'm just not watching the news, because when it happens, I know when y'all going to tell me about it. And I'm going to be like, I think that might be it. We just have to stay. But we still got to slow down and we got to watch. Yeah. And what I'm trying to tell you is this, is that I personally believe, you call me crazy. Just don't tell anybody you got a crazy preacher unless you're going to leave the church. I personally believe that World War II was a dry run. That's my opinion. A dry run towards a new world order. An attempt to play it out. Now, you realize how much planning that would require? Do you realize how many people would have to be involved in that? The heads of nations? Oh, that's impossible, man. I've had people scoff at me and laugh at me and say, dude, you're a fool. That you would think that people could pull off some kind of a plan like that and nobody know about it. I'm like, dude, all you got to do is keep on watching the news, guys. Y'all keep on watching the news and you'll see what they can pull over your eyes. I mean, I'm just messing with you. If you want to watch the news, watch the news. But what I'm trying to tell you is that they're feeding us. They're feeding us and brainwashing us to hear, for the most part, what they want us to hear. But anyway, that's another story.
Yeah.
What happened was in this situation was is that you had a, and I know I've shown most of y'all this picture before, you got a world leader, Adolf Hitler, and you got a religious figure, Pope Pius VII, I believe it was. Now, what's the big deal with somebody meeting with Hitler and just being in the same room with him? I mean, they're not even shaking hands right there. But it's documented in history that they signed a treaty. It's called the Reichskonkordat. And they signed that treaty, and a big part of it was in Italy. It was actually before Pius was the Pope. He was a cardinal in Italy. And they signed the Concordat, and what it did was it helped bring Hitler to power. And they also signed one in Italy. Mussolini signed one with him. And what it did was it caused the people to vote these leaders in. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that I'm not saying that that's what that was, and I'm not saying that the Pope going over there, wherever he's going to Jerusalem, is what that is. But what I am saying is that I expect it to look something like this. So a false prophet, some type of a prominent religious leader. And I've probably worn all this stuff out. We're about to start a series called Occult Exposure. I'm going to teach it for 6 weeks. We're not going to tape it. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the history of the Jesuits, because I feel like it's important for us to know these things. It's time for, I feel like the Lord wants these things exposed. And, you know, we got the first pope that's a Jesuit. I mean, if you knew the history of the Jesuit priesthood.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so something's on the rise. But this is a counterfeit trinity. And what you see is that's just a picture I found of the dragon. And then a false prophet. And then and the beast, the two different beasts. And so it's a counterfeit and it's a perversion of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And the false prophet is able to call fire down from heaven, and he's able to do all of these miracles and all of these various things to deceive the masses and the multitudes, to push them against God, and really and truly what ends up happening is, I think we're going to probably shut down here in a couple minutes, but really and truly what ends up happening here is that it appears that the enemy's having his way, but God is always ultimately in control, and he knows exactly, he created the enemy.
Amen.
And he knows exactly what his plans are, and he's always one step ahead, and the enemy doesn't even realize it, but he's falling into the plans of God. And so, real quick, and I guess we'll just close with this slide here, and this is kind of just repeating something that I've already been saying, that through the ages, God has been working his plan. And what is the purpose of the plan? Well, the purpose of the plan, like I mentioned earlier, has to do with the book of Ephesians. That God is creating an eternal family. You know, I don't mean to get philosophical on you, but, you know, King David, I just believe he was probably looking in a reflection when he said it, when he wrote, "What is man that you are mindful of him? And the son of man." I mean, maybe he's dressed in his royal splendor, and he can see his reflection, and he realizes also what manner of man that he is, you know, and the mistakes that he's made, and he loves God so much, and he questions, what is man that you're mindful of him? And, you know, the truth of the matter is, I don't know that any of us can answer that question, but hopefully it's a question that we've asked about our own hearts and our own lives, and we've questioned, like, what is it, God? Why would you do all this, you know? And I can tell you this, the Bible says God is love. And I believe with all my heart that the reason that God created us was because he wanted a creation that could reciprocate love to him. That had a free will. that would say, you know what, God, I love you. I love you and I choose you. And I want to live for you.
Amen.
And he wants that. And he has created a scenario where we can choose that. And we can spend eternity with him. And so he's creating an eternal family. But in order for that person to really exercise their free will and to have a choice, then there has to be a choice. Because if you don't have a choice, then you don't have a choice. And so had God made man the way that man was made, and had there never been the ability of a fall, and had there never been the introduction of sin, and had there never been the liar, and it's not that God ever really wanted all that to happen. That wasn't his perfect will. But he knew it was going to happen. He knew when he made Satan or Lucifer, whatever you want to call him, that he had within him the ability to fall. And he knew that he would fall. And he knew that when he created Adam out of the pristine ground that wasn't fallen and breathed life into his lungs, that Adam would also go the way of the liar. And that it would infect the entirety of the human race. Because each and every human being that has ever walked the face of the earth, save Jesus Christ, has been born of the loins of Adam and has been part of Adam's fallen race. And so God had a big plan. And then ultimately his plan starts with love and a desire to have an eternal family of people that would love him and would rule and reign with him and live with him and enjoy fellowship with him. And in the midst of this plan, God has been bringing it forward, this plan of redemption to bring man to him. He created Israel out of Abraham. From the nation of Israel, he gave us Jesus. And through Jesus, he's creating a new people that called the church, the body of Christ. Amen. And all along those ages, lights in the midst of darkness, vessels that have spoken of the truth of God. And at the same time, I put Mystery Babylon real, kind of faded it out because I was trying to make a point. Can you see?
Yeah.
I faded it out because that's what the word means. It's a mystery. It's hard to see. You can't really discern it. That's why that old boy told me, you're crazy, man. Little chubby boy from South Louisiana, you think you got this whole thing figured out? Well, no, I definitely don't have this whole thing figured out. But I'll tell you one thing. I feel like God allowed me to see that there's something going on that I wasn't able to see before in this world.
Right.
The spirit of Antichrist has a plan, and he's moving it forward. And he's moving everything towards a new world order, and he's used, and we'll get into this next time, what Mystery Babylon consists of is a Babylonian religion, Babylonian governments, and a Babylonian financial system that God will destroy when it's all said and done. Amen? Praise the Lord.